In this session, we're going to look at our first classifier called the k-nearest neighbors. Actually, we did talk about another classifier earlier on, which was the naive rule. Remember, that's going to be the benchmark always. What is the k-nearest neighbor algorithm? Well, let's think of some applications to see what's the idea behind this classifier. So for instance, how are searching on Google and getting insurance quotes similar? When you type some keywords in google.com, in the search engine, how does it know which results to give you back? Or when you fill out an online form for insurance, how does it know what quote to give you back? The idea behind both of these applications is that they're comparing the information that you convey to information conveyed by other users. And the key here is trying to detect similarities between you and other users, and let's go back to an example that we saw earlier on for a bank, Maharaja Bank, run a campaign for current customers to purchase a loan. To improve target marketing, they want to identify the customers that are most likely to accept the loan offer. Now that we've talked about performance evaluation, what type of objective is this? Is this profiling? Is this classification? Is this ranking? The Maharaja Bank uses data from a previous campaign on 5,000 customers, where out of these 5,000, only 480 accepted. We have a data dictionary in the Excel file mentioned here at the bottom. The Y variable of interest is personal loan, and this is a binary variable that tells you whether the customer accepted or did not accept the loan. We have a bunch of demographic information, as well as some banking information. We'll use this example to illustrate a few of the next classifiers. The first step is always to try and plot the data, and we talked about interactive visualization. For example, I can plot here two of the predictors on the axes, income and credit card average, a monthly average credit card spending. And then I use color to denote the Y variable, which is the acceptors versus the non-acceptors. What does k-nearest neighbor try to do? Suppose we have a new person coming in. So our training set are all the blue and orange dots, and this green dot here is a new person who comes in. How can I classify based on this person's profile in terms of the X's, in this case, income and credit card average spending, how can I classify this person as either an acceptor or a non-acceptor of the loan? In k-nearest neighbors, we're going to look for a few other customers that are in our previous campaign data that are most similar to this person in terms of their profile. And again, that means in terms of their predictor information. How do I determine how many neighbors? We'll talk about that soon. But suppose we're looking for three neighbors. So k is equal to three. I identify the three neighbors that are nearest or most similar to this particular customer. And then I simply let these three customers vote. Did the majority of them accept the offer, or did the majority reject the offer? In this case, the blue are the acceptors, and we see that two out of these three neighbors actually rejected the offer. The k-nearest neighbor algorithm in this case would predict the result for this new person as someone who would not accept your offer. That's a very graphical description of what k-nearest neighbors does. Let's just formalize and see what happens behind the scenes. So step number one, the KNN algorithm is going to compute the distance between every new record that you want to classify to each and every record in the training set. Then, among all these records in the training set, it's going to identify the K shortest distances. These are called the nearest neighbors. And once we have these nearest neighbors, we're going to let them vote in terms of the Y variable, in terms of the class that they are members of. This is going to be done for each and every record that we want to classify. When we're just evaluating performance on a holdout set, it means that we're going to have to go through steps 1, 2, and 3 for every record in this holdout set. Now, when we're talking about how far a record is from other neighbors, we have to talk about distances. If you've already gone through the cluster analysis sessions, then you already know that distances can be all kinds of things. with simple things such as Euclidean distance or moving further into more intricate distances. So just a quick reminder, we use d sub ij to denote the distance between records I and j. And here in this supervised learning task, we're measuring distance only in terms of the x variables. So neighbors are people who have the same x profile, same predictor profile. And of course, we can use different distances, but the typical requirements are that a distance is non-negative, that the distance between a record and itself is zero, that the distance between record I and J is equivalent to the distance between record J and I, and the triangle inequality, which we discussed in the cluster analysis session. I can measure in this example, I can take two customers, and for each one, I have a profile in terms of their age, their experience, their income level, perhaps the size of their family, and their credit card average spending. And to measure the distance between this customer and customer number two, I can use any type of distance. For example, I can use Euclidean distance, which simply takes the difference in income and squares it, the difference in age and squares it, and so on. In other words, by looking at these five predictor measures, I can compute a five-dimensional distance. And the distance for these particular two customers, if we round the numbers here, will be 30.82. There's no real meaning to this number, 30.82, but remember that what we care about is just sorting the distances so that we can find the nearest neighbors. Remember the issue of Euclidean distance, where if we have more than one measurement and the measurements have different scales, we must first normalize or standardize the measurements so that everything is on the same scale. Otherwise, measures that have the largest unit will actually take over the distance and nothing else will matter. We also mentioned lots of other types of distance metrics, such as statistical distance. Check the textbook under discriminant analysis for more on that. Or Manhattan distance, where instead of squares, we look at absolute values. We talked about matching type metrics when we have categorical or binary data. And more and more. There are also other distances that we didn't measure here, and it's useful to try different distances because different data might actually benefit from different distance metrics. There's a well-known data mining, a relatively early data mining application, where there was a competition for identifying handwritten zip codes on envelopes in order to improve the postal service's recognition of zip codes on envelopes. And it turned out that the winning application was based on a distance called the tangent distance. And that distance was able to create the best recovery of zip codes from handwritten digits. In Excel Miner, we're going to find the k-nearest neighbor and other classifiers in the classification menu. There's also an option that will automatically normalize the data before running KNN. So that saves us a step of normalization. Now, I'll note that you'll also find KNN in another menu. It's going to be under the prediction menu in Excel Miner. And the reason is, we'll talk about this later on, that KNN can also be used to predict a numerical Y, not only a categorical Y. So this is a very useful and flexible method. What type of distance will your software use? Well, that depends on the software. In most cases, software will use by default, or maybe only, Euclidean distance. The reason is computational. If you think again about the algorithm, you'll note that there's a lot of computations of distances going on. You have to compute the distance between each record to be classified with each record in the training data. And when we have a very large training set, which is a good thing, we're going to have lots of computations. That's why we usually want to pick a distance metric that is simple and fast to compute. And Euclidean distance is one of the ideal candidates. Now the question is, how many neighbors to choose? Why did I choose three? Maybe I should choose seven. We have here an issue of smoothing. If you think of a histogram and how you choose the bin width, it's the same problem. If you choose a bin width that's too wide, you're going to get over-smoothing. If you choose a bin width that's very narrow, you're going to get under-smoothing. And the same thing is happening with the choice of neighbors. If you choose many, many neighbors and think of the extreme case, what's the largest number of neighbors you can have? Well, it's the size of the training set. So if you take the entire set of neighbors, What do you actually get when you let them vote? You get the naive rule, and that is over-smoothing. The other extreme is choosing only a single record as being a neighbor. And if we're thinking of a single neighbor, then there's a lot of noise because perhaps you have one person that's similar to you in terms of their profile, but they happen to be different in terms of their outcome. So that would be called under-smoothing. There's no steadfast rule on what's the correct K. Typically, K is lower than 20, but that doesn't have to be the case in all applications. The solution, the data mining solution, is to actually use a validation set in order to find the best K. So the idea is we have a training set where we're going to be computing all these distances. We're going to have a validation set that's going to help us find the best K, but that also means that we're going to have to keep a third piece out there, which is going to be a real holdout that will not be used at all by the algorithm, because that's the only set that will be able to evaluate predictive performance in an objective way. Here's the output of K-nearest neighbors using Excel Miner. What we see here are confusion matrices, one for the training data and one for the validation data. And these are generic. This is the type of output you'll get for every classifier. You'll notice that we have the cutoff value of 0.5, and on the Excel Miner sheet, you can change this number interactively so that the classification matrix numbers will adjust accordingly. There's also a small summary table that summarizes the errors that show up in the confusion matrix. So what's special about the k-nearest neighbor output? That's what we have here on the left-hand side. Once you partition the data in Excel Miner and run any classifier on the partition sheet, Excel Miner will know to only use the training data for fitting the algorithm. It will use the validation data, in this case, to choose K. And if we kept a separate test data, it will give us separate metrics on the test data as well. Here's what Excel Miner did for finding the best K. It tried a bunch of different Ks, and you can tell it how far to go. Of course, the larger K you choose, the longer you'll have to wait for the software to compute. And we can see the percentage of error on the training set and the percentage of error on the validation set. Now look for a minute at the percentage of error on the training set. As we choose fewer and fewer neighbors, the error gets smaller, meaning that the training set really wants you to choose one neighbor, and that will give you zero error. Why is that the case? Stop the video and think for a minute. So why does the training data want you to use a single neighbor? The reason is that it is comparing a certain record in the training data to its closest neighbor. Who is its closest neighbor? It's the same record itself. So obviously, the training data wants you to do exactly that. And that's what we call overfitting. In contrast, when you take a record in the validation set and you ask how many neighbors should I use, then it won't necessarily tell you that you want a single neighbor. And in fact, here we're trying different values of K, and we see that the best K is when we choose four neighbors. This is going to give us a 3.8% error in the validation set. And we can see down here that when we choose K equals 4, we indeed get 3.8%. Now ask yourself this question. When we go and deploy this KNN algorithm on a whole new fresh set of data, are we really going to get an error rate of about 3.8%? Or is it likely to be worse? Or is it maybe going to be better? Note that we can also generate a lift chart. And the question is, what is the objective? We wouldn't just generate all of this information. If our objective is ranking, if we're trying to find the most likely customers to accept the offer, then the lift chart is the correct performance measure to use. And in this case, I can exactly see that the lift is very high. It's much better than random assignment. So KNN is going to also give us probabilities of a certain class. For example, probability of success. You'll note that some of the numbers here are 0, some are 0.5, some are 0.25. And to convert these probabilities into predicted classes, we're again going to have to choose a cutoff value. So there's nothing new here. This is exactly the same approach that we talked about when we discussed performance evaluation. The default that Excel Miner uses is 0.5. And that's why the only record that gets classified here as a success is the record right there. What's going to happen when I change the cutoff? Say if I reduce the cutoff threshold to 0.2. One more thing to notice. How do I actually get the probability here? Probabilities in K-nearest neighbors are simply the proportion of votes that we get for that class. So if I had four neighbors, which was our example here, and two out of the neighbors said success and two out of the neighbors said failure, then I would get a probability of 0.5. A probability of zero would be the case if all four neighbors were actually failures. So let's summarize K and N. How does the algorithm train? We give it a large set of data, and for each record in this training data, we're going to compute the K nearest records and let them vote to get a classification. This step is going to be repeated with different values of K in order to determine the best K. And in order to do that, we're going to have to use the validation set, which means that the algorithm is no longer agnostic to the validation set. That's why we also need a third test set to evaluate performance. And lastly, we're going to have to choose a cutoff value in order to convert the votes, which give us a percentage or a probability, into an actual classification. Okay, so that was the training phase. Now let's move into the classification phase. In the classification phase, we have a set of new records that we want to classify. For each one of these records, we're going to have to find the k-nearest records in the training data and let those neighbors vote to get a classification. We can do the exact same thing if we have a numerical Y. The only difference is that instead of a vote, we'll aggregate the neighbors' results, Y results, for instance, by taking an average or taking a median. And finally, in the classification case, if I want to get a class probability, I'll have to compute the percentage of votes of the class of interest among the neighbors. So this is K and N, and it's easy to explain, but it's going to require quite a lot of data. So here are the advantages and disadvantages. K and N is very flexible, and it's also very data-driven. You'll notice that it's quite automated. You hardly had to specify anything. It's simple to explain to people, and it actually works reasonably well if you have sufficient data. The other condition is that we need to have sufficient representation of the different predictor information. So if I'm classifying people based on neighbors in terms of their predictor profiles, I have to have sufficient representation of the different types of predictor profiles in my training data. As I mentioned earlier on, we can use KNN either for classification or for predicting a numerical Y. So what are the disadvantages? There's no free lunch. Every classifier will have its strengths and weaknesses. First of all, you'll notice that we get no insight about which predictor is important, which predictor is actually more useful in generating the outcome. This is what's called a black box. Another big danger is that of overfitting, and that's why we always require an extra holdout set to make sure that our performance is reasonably good on new data that the algorithm never saw. As we start increasing K and trying out different values, this can be computationally complicated. So don't be surprised if you're waiting and waiting in front of your computer if you're trying to fit a large number of neighbors. And finally, again, you're going to need a lot of data. Because we're not making any assumptions, there are no parametric assumptions or a mathematical model going on, all the patterns are being learned directly from the data. So it's good, but it's also bad. It means that you need a lot of data for the algorithm to learn. And in fact, the more predictors you have, the more data you're going to need. So go ahead and try K-nearest neighbors. See if you find any issues, and of course, report your results on the forum.